Hello. In this video, I am going to discuss a video by Nighthawk in Light from 2017 with regard to turning salt water into fresh water. Though I have used the word debunked in the title of my video, I think of this more as an opportunity to show how we can apply the theoretical principles of the physical sciences to a real-world problem, and then mention some practical difficulties that one would notice when trying to carry this out in the real world. The apparatus used by Nighthawk in Light consists of a pair of glass bottles, and I'm demonstrating using plastic here. In the leftmost container, we would fill this up with salt water that perhaps you would obtain from the ocean. We would heat this fluid up until it boiled, and then the steam would condense in the rightmost glass bottle. We notice that we've made a number of assumptions even at the very beginning of our process. The first is we seem to have been stranded on an island, perhaps in the Pacific, where we would have access to large quantities of salt water. Two, we were fortunate enough to have found on this island not one, but two glass bottles that happened to have very similar size necks. This particular arrangement for distillation has at least two major deficiencies. The first major deficiency is that the two bottles are in thermal contact. So as we heat up the bottle with salt water over here, some of our heat, instead of being used to raise the temperature of water and then convert it into a gas, is used simply to heat the bottle on the right. In the video, it is mentioned to use water and or a cold towel to cool this particular bottle down. That is certainly possible. But the more we cool this particular bottle down, the greater the heat flow we have from this bottle to that bottle, and the more that this particular bottle acts as a siphon on the energy that we want to use to convert the water into steam. The second problem is that if we push these two bottles together, we notice that even under the best of circumstances, there is a very small gap between the two rims. Even if this were not so, even if we could line up both the bottles so perfectly that there was absolutely no gap between the two, as we boil the water in the leftmost bottle, it's going to be converted into gas. The gas is going to increase the pressure inside the two-bottle system, and that is going to force the two bottles apart. If the bottles become forced apart to any extent at all, the steam that is generated in this particular bottle, rather than transferring and condensing into this bottle, will mostly just evaporate directly vertically into the atmosphere and be wasted. So we are making a huge assumption, even in the calculations that I'm going to show, that the water that we have and boil and convert into steam here is transferred with 100% fidelity to the rightmost bottle, because that will surely not be true. The third deficiency of this particular arrangement is that the bottles are arranged horizontally. As a result, this particular bottle on the left-hand side, which is 16 fluid ounces in imperial units and nearly 500 milliliters in SI, we can only fill up with 175 milliliters of water, because past that point, it would start to flow into the neck and then into the other bottle without having been distilled. So this fact that we are only using a very small proportion of the available storage volume in the distilling flask is going to turn out to be another major deficiency of this proposed method. Now I am going to list the assumptions that I have made in doing the calculations that are involved in the boiling of this particular salt water. We're going to assume that the bottles are glass and that they have a volume, V, of 16 fluid ounces. So this is the imperial measurement, and 500 milliliters in metric. Also, the mass of the glass, the bottle, is 400 grams. This is a representative value that I found by looking at manufacturers of particularly green glass bottles used for beverages. In performing the distillation, we're going to use the glass bottle on its side, as shown in Nighthawk and Light's video, and then the volume is only 175 milliliters. So we see that we have a very large reduction from 500 to 175 of available space that we can use for the distillation of water. We're also going to assume that, like Nighthawk and Light, that we are going to use some sand to help distribute the heat better. And I'm going to use a very, very small amount of sand. And we're going to assume that it is a pile of sand that is only 500 milliliters in volume. So it's essentially equal in volume to the glass bottle, enough to just get a thin layer surrounding it. Important thing to keep in mind is that if we have sand, a typical density for sand is about 1.5 grams per milliliter. Which gives us a mass of sand of 750 grams. Let us also make some assumptions as to the environmental conditions. Let's assume that we are at sea level, so that the pressure is 1 atmosphere. Likewise, the normal boiling point of water will be 100 degrees centigrade at this particular pressure. And let's also assume that the temperature is 30 degrees centigrade, which seems to be a typical median value for islands in the Pacific. And for my American friends, this is equivalent to 86 degrees Fahrenheit. What first seemed to be a simple process, we will see is actually rather complex. In order to distill the salt water, we are going to have to heat the sand up to 100 degrees centigrade. We are going to have to heat the glass of the bottle up to 100 degrees centigrade. We are going to have to raise the temperature of the liquid water up to 100 degrees centigrade. And then we have to convert the water that's a liquid water at 100 degrees centigrade to steam, to vapor, at 100 degrees centigrade. So we have at least 4 different heating processes that we are going to have to account for. And we shall do that right now. Now we can calculate exactly how much thermal energy, this Q sub sand, is required to heat the sand up from 30 degrees centigrade all the way up to 100 degrees centigrade. We notice in our equation that M is the mass of the sand, S sub sand, this is the specific heat capacity of sand, and delta T is the change in temperature. Since we're going from 30 to 100 degrees centigrade, our change in temperature is 70 degrees centigrade. So our mass of sand, we have already determined to be 750 grams. And keep in mind that this is a very conservative estimate. The amount of sand that would probably be used in a real circumstance would not be weighed out this precisely. You would probably use a large excess of sand. The specific heat capacity of sand is 0.80 joules per gram degree centigrade. And the change in temperature is 70 degrees centigrade. We are going to perform a calculation and we get the result in the units of joules. So for the case of sand, we get that it's going to require 42,000 joules of heat for just the step of heating the sand from 30 degrees centigrade to 100 degrees centigrade. Next, we can find the amount of thermal energy Q sub glass that's required to heat up just one of the glass bottles from 30 to 100 degrees Celsius. We have already used the fact that the mass of one glass bottle is 400 grams. The specific heat capacity S sub glass is 0.84 joules per gram degree centigrade. And the temperature change is exactly the same because the glass is also going from 30 degrees to 100 degrees Celsius. So this gives us a temperature change of 70 degrees Celsius. Again, we get an answer in joules, and this value is 23,500 joules. Notice this is put per bottle, just to remind ourselves that this is for just one of the bottles. Now we find the amount of thermal energy required to raise the temperature of the salt water from 30 degrees centigrade to 100 degrees centigrade while still remaining as the liquid phase. So we know that we have 175 grams. The volume was 175 milliliters. We'll make the assumption that the density of water is close to 1 gram per milliliter, so we can immediately write down the approximation as 175 grams. The specific heat capacity of water is very large. It's 4.184 joules per gram degree centigrade. And the change in temperature is 70 degrees Celsius. When we multiply this together, we get the value of 51,254 joules. So this is to go from 30 to 100 Celsius while remaining as a liquid. Then the final sub-calculation that we need to perform involves the amount of thermal energy required to convert liquid water at 100 degrees Celsius to vapor from liquid to steam while staying at 100 degrees centigrade. So we use a slightly different formula where N here is now the number of moles of liquid water, and we multiply it by a quantity which we call the heat of vaporization or the enthalpy of vaporization, which is delta H sub vape. So a thing to notice here is that we have 175 grams of water. The molar mass of water is just about 18 grams for 1 mole of H2O. So this tells us that we have 9.7 moles of H2O here. And we need that for our calculation because we have 9.7 moles here. So this is our value of N. And then the enthalpy of vaporization for water is 40,650 joules per mole. Again, we're going to get an answer in terms of joules. And we see, in this case, it's 394,305 joules. One thing you will notice immediately is that the energy required simply to change water from liquid to steam while staying at 100 degrees Celsius is very much larger than any of the other energy needs that we have for this operation. The reason is that water has very strong hydrogen bonding, a very strong intermolecular force, so we need a very large quantity of thermal energy to overcome those intermolecular forces. This is also gives us pause in every wanting to boil water, because boiling water is an incredibly energy intensive process. If we are going to die without it, for example, if we are on a desert island and we have no potable drinking water, then we need to do whatever we can to obtain such water. If we have any other method of obtaining drinking water, those methods would surely be more practical than investing this very large amount of energy into boiling water. We add these components together, we get a total of 534,600 joules. That's the total amount of energy we need, but we have to make some assumptions as to how we're going to heat the water up. So let's make an assumption here that we're using a heater, either electric or a flame, that has a output of 1500 watts. This would be a typical laboratory heater. And realize that watts are equivalent to joules per second. So a heater with an output of 1500 watts delivers 1500 joules per second. So let's see how long it's going to take, even being incredibly optimistic, assuming we have no thermal losses at all, and we don't lose any of the material in the process of the distillation. How long is it going to take to distill that 175 milliliters of water? Well, we have a total of 534,600 joules that we need to send. And in 1 second, we can deliver 1500 joules. So when we do that, this gives us 356 seconds. And we can round this very quickly to about 6 minutes. A thing to realize is that assuming just for the boiling of water here, this is 6 minutes for 175 milliliters. So let me emphasize that fact here. How much liquid water would a person need in a survival situation? Well, the general value that I have found is that one person requires 3.7 liters per day. This is very close to 1 US gallon. Well, in each distillation process, even under the most optimistic, wildly optimistic estimates, we can only distill 175 milliliters. So how many of these distillation processes would be required to get our full recommended allowance of 3.7 liters of pure drinking water? Well, let's see. 3.7 liters is equal to 3,700 milliliters. And in each distillation, I get 175 milliliters. We'll call this a run. So say in one run of the operation, we get 175 milliliters. And we realize that we're going to need to perform this process 21 times. So we're going to need 21 runs of this each and every day if this is our only supply of water. And this is 21 runs per day per person. In his video, Night Hawk and Light suggests the possibility that the method he describes might be suitable for multiple people. That is probably unrealistic because we'll see how long it's going to take to perform the number of runs required under the most optimistic conditions for one person. And we see that the possibility of using this one method, one installation, for more than one person is not feasible. Since we are performing this distillation on water that is originally from the oceans, it is salt water. So let's now account for the salt. A typical value for the amount of salt in an ocean is about 3.5%. So it's about 3.5% sodium chloride and other salts. So we notice that we have, in each run, we have 175 grams of water, of our total solution. And then 3.5% of that mass will turn out to be salt. So that's equivalent to multiplying by 0.035. And we see in each of these runs that we get a total of 6.1 grams of salt. We have not made use of the fact that of our 175 grams of initial material, that 6 grams of that is turning out to be salt as opposed to water. The one implication I'm going to mention here is that after each run, there's going to be a substantial amount of salt remaining in the glass bottle. So what the person is going to want to do is, after each run, is to remove the salt. Because if you didn't remove the salt, you would notice that after 20 runs, you'd have 120 grams of salt. It would fill up more than half the available space in the bottle. So if we're going to be optimistic, and in each run actually achieve our goal of getting a full 175 milliliters of drinkable water, we would need to remove the salt after each run. In Night Hawk in Light's 8.5 minute video, he only shows us the intermediate part of one particular run. So even to achieve a single run completely, isn't going to involve a large number of steps, which were not explicitly mentioned in the video. And I would like to list them here so that we would have a better idea on how practical this method would be in a severe survival situation. Step one would be to assemble the distillation apparatus. This assumes already that we've already obtained the two glass bottles, and that's not going to be included in each additional run, but we need to set up the bottles next to each other and make sure that we put the 175 milliliters of salt water, of the brine, in one of the bottles, and that the other bottle is clean and empty. In step two, we need to actually start our fire. Depending upon the conditions, this can be an extremely critical and labor-intensive step. But we'll assume here that one has available all the materials and the knowledge to make fire virtually on demand. We would still need to start the fire here and allow it to progress long enough that it will generate on the order of 1,500 watts of heat. One might make the objection that a fire in real life would have an output that is greater than 1,500 watts, which is a legitimate objection. On the other hand, if the fire were to become too hot, generate too much heat, then there is the great danger that we could crack the bottle. Cracking either the two bottles in this particular circumstance, if we only had two bottles, would be a fatal event. So we would need to be very careful that we apply heat to the bottles in a controlled manner and not become impatient, because if we become impatient, overheat the bottles, that leads to them cracking, we have very, very big problems. In step three, we perform the distillation. In that particular step, we distill 175 milliliters of water to obtain, wildly optimistically, 175 milliliters of pure drinking water at a time that we saw could be no quicker than 6 minutes. In step four, we would have to actually stop the fire to remove the source of heat. In the laboratory, we would have the ability to simply use mittens or tongs to pick up the hot piece of apparatus and slide away the heater. But in a survival situation, we would not have that capability. And we have to watch out for the fact that we don't want to overheat the bottle, particularly an empty bottle that has no water in it. In the presence of fire, will heat up very, very quickly, and there will be a huge danger of it cracking. Second, Later, we're going to see, we're going to have to handle the bottle again. We're going to need to refill it, as in step one, with 175 milliliters of more salt water. We want to be very careful of how we interact with the bottle. If we touch a hot bottle with a bare hand, we will burn ourselves, and that may be a fatal event in a survival situation. We're assuming that we don't have at hand a thermal mitt or some other such bit of specialized equipment, so therefore we would have to actually extinguish our fire to allow the bottle to cool down, to interact with it later on, and to perform the next run. In step five, we have to do some disassembly of the apparatus. On one hand, we want to retrieve the fresh water, perhaps to drink it or to put it into some safe container for later. And we also have to eventually remove the bottle that we're using to hold the salt water at the beginning of the distillation, because we're going to need to perform step six, where we let the bottle cool. Letting the bottle cool is one of the most important steps, and it is a step that was overlooked in Nighthawk and Light's video. Even if we were to assume that we could heat up the bottle from 30 to 100 degrees in 6 minutes without cracking it, once all the water has been removed from the inside of the bottle, the water is the ingredient that tends to, that has the highest specific heat, so therefore it minimizes the change in temperatures. Once the water has all evaporated out or been boiled out, the bottle itself's temperature will skyrocket from 100 degrees centigrade up to several hundred degrees. So allowing the bottle to cool is going to take at least more than 6 minutes, because if we cool it down any faster than we heated it up, assume we're heating it up at about the maximum rate that we can do without breaking it, if we were to cool it more quickly, we would have the great danger of it breaking as well. Then in step seven, after the bottle has cooled sufficiently that we can handle it without endangering ourselves, we know that in each particular run, we have slightly more than 6 grams of salt that are remaining in the bottle. And we are going to want to remove that particular salt, because any salt that is in the bottle will minimize the amount of water that we can boil in the next step. So we have methodically worked out the various steps that are involved in doing just one run of distillation of 175 milliliters of water to convert salt water into fresh water. Now we have to make some assumptions, or at least some estimates, as to how long all these steps are going to take together. How long would it take from the beginning of assembling the apparatus to perform one run until I'm ready to begin assembling the apparatus one more time? Personally, I think an overly optimistic value for all these steps is going to be 30 minutes. And I imagine I will receive a great deal of criticism from commenters who will insist that these steps could be formed more quickly. Therefore, I would suggest, before anyone responds and says that, which might be a very valid objection, is for them to actually do each and every step of the process and see how long it takes in real life to do it. Assuming, even then, that you're doing it well-fed, you're not thirsty, you don't have the sun beating down on your head, you may not have been near drowning because of a shipwreck or a crash of an airplane, you're under the absolute maximum health, you have time to assemble all the materials in the most efficient arrangement before you begin, and then see how quickly you could do this. And realize that if you cannot do it in 30 minutes, that in a survival situation, you would not be able to do it in 30 minutes either. But let's, as a ballpark figure, let's assume that we could do it in 30 minutes. Let's assume that we could for each run. Let's see how long of our day we would have to devote to distilling water to distill the minimum amount of drinking water required for us to stay alive Again, assuming that we found the bottles and we could start a fire and all these assumptions, and also assume that we didn't have large heat losses in the process of heating up our bottle, and assuming that we didn't crack the bottle at any step along the way. How long would it take? We have already determined that it's going to take us 21 runs at a minimum under the most optimistic scenario to distill the 3.7 liters of water required for just one person to stay alive for one day. We've assumed that one run at the absolute most optimistic can be done in 30 minutes. So multiplying this out, we see that this is 630 minutes, which is 10 and a half hours. So 10 and a half hours that one is not doing anything else but standing over the fire, watching the apparatus very carefully, because you dare not walk away, because if you do, the two bottles would be out of contact perhaps. We would not collect material in the collection vessel so that all the water that you distilled would be wasted during that particular run. So this would require one person's full attention for 10 and a half hours during the day. So in summary, this method, even accounting for the fact that we would lose a very large amount of the pure water because of the contact between the two bottles, because there would have to be a crack, so you would not get the full 175 milliliters of water to distill over. It'd be much less than 100%. Even if we were to imagine we got it 100%, we had the glass bottles. The glass bottles didn't break. We were able to continually fill and empty the bottles, start the fire without burning ourselves in the process. It would still require almost 10 and a half hours of continuous deliberate attention to get the absolute minimum drinking water for one person. Thank you very much for your attention. In a future video, I would like to show a way that we could adapt Nighthawk and Light's proposed method and run it more efficiently in the guise of a survival circumstance. Could we take the same basic principles and use them to more efficiently generate pure drinking water? But until then, I thank you very much for your attention, and as always, have a good one.